This will be done again then. So let me just start because it's very many here. Thank you for coming. Last, always they're always late, these two. So then I will just start. The talk is then about flexible content editing with paragraphs and Drupal 8. And this is basically a little case study showcase of our latest project, what we built and went live now in the 1st of April. My name is Patti Sonja Breivert, so two of those names are not my names where I got born with. So my real, my name is then Bjarney Sonja Ólafsdóttir. So I'm the daughter of Olaf and I come from Iceland and my dad's name is Olaf. My brother is then Jason Olafsson and I am Patti Ólafsdóttir. Because I'm the daughter of Olaf and my brother is the son of Olaf. Obvious, right? I then got married to a German guy, so therefore I took his the one in the end there. And then I took his name, so the middle name is the only name that I actually got born with. Bjarney, I decided it was too complicated to use in Germany, so I use my short name, Patti. So you can call me whatever you want. I have a bachelor in computer science from the Reykjavik University. Then I went to study master in engineering management in TU Wien, where I also participated in European or in robot football, like soccer with robotics, where I actually became a European champion in 2008. That was a big success because I was playing for Austria, and Austria was in 2008 not very good in football, but we were really good in robotic football. And we even won against Darmstadt in a session in TU Darmstadt, and that was like a big success that TU Wien, you know, won TU Darmstadt. So like for you guys that are from Darmstadt there in the enough about that, when we were playing with robotics, and which I still do with these little kids here, we started to play with Drupal in about 2007, when it was in version 5, we completely did everything wrong. We just hacked everything directly. We did, you know, we thought that you could just go into the core and just, if you need to change anything, you just change it there, and then in the next update, oops, it was gone. But we liked the technology, we liked Drupal. We saw in 2007 that Drupal had a good chance of becoming what it is actually today. So therefore we founded our company. So I also have a husband sitting in the audience, also having a couple of sessions, which I also own the company with. And these two kids wearing the Druid t-shirts from the Finnish company. We get every year t-shirts for our kids in DrupalCon Europe. So if you have kids, if you go to DrupalCon Vienna, go to Druid. The Finnish guys, they're a little bit crazy. Listen to metal rock. Go to them and they will probably give you t-shirts for your kids. Enough about that. My company and our company, it's OneX Internet. We are in Frankfurt with you're probably 12 here or 13 in Frankfurt. I think 13, and we speak 12 languages, or we are 12 nationalities. So we speak English at work. We also have 1.5 employees in Barcelona and in Reykjavik, also a couple based on my, like where I come from, Iceland. So I founded the Drupal Iceland. And we organized for the first time a camp now in February, the Northern Lights camp, which is the coolest camp ever. I told you earlier, it was literally the coolest camp ever. Not because it was cool, but it was really cold. So what happened there, there came like 50 people from the States, there came 50 people from Europe. Some of you here were in Iceland. And we gathered there together because for both it was easy to come to Iceland. That was a big success, actually, to have the people from the States coming in and meeting the people from Europe, which was a little bit sometimes missed, especially in these camps. What Ruben also talked about, thank you for that, in the GitPal introduction earlier is that based on that, you know, for example, his project got taken one step further and is now being developed together with people from Drupal user group in Boston. So we, of course, are organizing again Drupal Camp next year or the year after. But that time we're going to do also a really cool camp. We're going to do on the 20th of June, we're going to do a solstice camp, which is the midnight summer, where we are trying to organize it that we go swimming around midnight and we do one, two sessions around midnight. That's probably going to be really cool in both directions. A little bit about the company, if you have been to previous talks, for example, from Christoph about DEGov, we have been part of the DEGov distribution. We do a lot in Drupal Commerce, and we launched now three Drupal Commerce sites on the 1st of April, so there is going to be a talk about that also tomorrow if you're interested in commerce and how that is now in Drupal 8 and our experience with that, and go come tomorrow and listen to Christoph's talk about that. It's really, like, because they are still, like, beta version came like out now in the middle of, a good version now in the middle of March, but still we have already taken three sites live there, so if you want to know a little bit about that, but, and that's part of our team in the cool atmosphere. Where the European Platoon and the American come together, and there we were all standing and did a group photo also, the whole camp, and this is from our people. So, enough about all that. This is just the background, so you also can, for opening up questions for later. But this talk is going to be a little bit about a showcase, which is, I hope that I can play that here. So this is the page that I'm actually going to be telling you about. It's Open Doors, and it's just a video running now. So what they is a really big organization here in worldwide, but we did it for the German Open Doors, and it is about, in German you say, verfolgte Christen, to help them, persecuted Christians, I would say in English. So basically they are looking at where Christians are being followed and killed around the world, and they are making information about how you can also report this. They are making reports about countries. And this is a very content-rich page with a lot of flexibility. And this was all thought about. The client wanted to have flexibility over everything. Every single color he wants to choose himself, he wants to choose all pages, he wants to make it really bunt, colorful. Don't ask why, but he really wants that. You know, he wants to control all the background pictures. So the URL to this is opendoors.de, if you want to look at it. Like I said earlier about the world map, where we use AM maps to generate all the, you know, they say who are the 10 worst countries in the world, and then there's country from 11 to 50, and you can see Nigeria is plus 12, the 12th place, North Korea is then the worst one, and then they make this big report. So a little bit for you guys to get the idea of what is here behind. So 95 million Christians, and then comes very long text. So our challenge here was that the client basically had to have a lot of flexibility to create a lot of different landing pages. They have both, you saw there, like I'm going to tell you about like what happens there when we inject stuff into CK Editor. But point is here is that the client wanted to be flexible, to be able basically to do whatever he wants and to create, because he has an editorial team. So there are very many editors, and they want to be able to do this all on the, you know, on their own. And not just have two, three templates. So before I show you a couple of the paragraphs that I'm actually going to talk about, I'm just telling you the facts, because if you're interested also in Drupal 8 and how this has been going. So the project started was almost a year ago, 10 months, so May 2016, where we then, for this project, we looked at the Bitbucket yesterday, Egypt, and it was Drupal 8.1.0. It was relatively early for this type of a project, but we said that we can do it, and we just were willing then to invest in that by contributing some back. In the end of the summer, around 8.1.7, we actually started to get a version where we started to feel good. Until then, it was a little bit shaky. Then, at the moment, we are still in 8.2.8. We haven't updated it to 8.3, and the reason is just we just went live with it, and you maybe just don't take the big, don't do the big update just before you go live. And therefore, we are just in the process of doing that, and it needs a lot of testing. Please, if you have questions, you can ask. So that's the actual stand of the project at the moment. Interestingly, we also built in a shop. And that we installed the first version of the shop on the 6th of October. So basically, we were in the Drupal Camp Dublin. We sat down with the commerce guys, Bojan and Ryan. We heard their talk and sat down with them and said, like, hey guys, are we ready? Can we do it? Because the client, we had decided to build Drupal 8, he wants a shop, he needs a shop. Are we there yet? Ooh, we got a little bit of a... if you're up for it, if you trust yourself that you can program a little bit there, you can do it. So we decided to take that jump. We installed that in October. Parallel, we also worked on another project that I told you about, which of course, you know, has been helping us to get to this stage. And these shops are the first shops, I think, that are made with Drupal 8 and launched. So it's very early still, but for a simple job like this, it's no problem. So the project launch was on the 1st of April. So, to the project itself, this big page that has all these sites, it's like hundreds of sites, has very few content types, and that was our mission, to reduce the content types, to not have all these different landing pages as content types, and instead use paragraphs. So there are basically three content types, and the basic page, events and news, and they just all basically only have a paragraph. If you look to the right, yeah, then you have, this is the manage fields inside the basic page. So you see there's a body field, there's a hide PDF button, because sometimes they do not want to have that, you can print it out and make PDF out of it, because they also produce some other material for it. Meta tags, and then teaser image for like when we want to reference that somewhere else. But most important, there's this like one field, paragraph field. Who has experience with paragraphs here? Okay, good. And paragraphs in Drupal 8? So, good. So you know this all. So actually, we don't have to go any further now. Then there is one content type called country profile, and that was what you saw in the end in the little screen where we actually have a page with a lot, like a really long content. There, it didn't work out to have paragraphs, and why? Is that because the client has needs to import all these reports just in, and that's not so simple just to do with to have. They also want to have it as a boring text, but then we decided to do something with that in CK Editor, which is going to come on, like show you in the end of the session. But how we could make the content then sexy with CK Editor. So that one has CK Editor, and then you have like prayers and jobs, and that we all just use the REST import interface. We import this all in really nice and easy with Drupal 8. So the paragraphs, there are 25 different paragraphs. And you could say that the client went on they basically got everything they wanted, which was good because they really thought that they needed it, and the good thing is they are using it all. So I know it's not possible, it's not possible at all to read it. But I put down a couple of them. So typical basic content is that something they use for impressum, center text, hero slider, hero image, new slider, media grid, banners, image blocks. And why did we really stick on using paragraphs? It's because this has to be simple for the people who are editing the page. It needs to be for them easy to go in and see everything. So some of you could say, like, why did not just use ESK or the entity part where you just reference entities and all that, because we are basically doing that with the paragraphs. And why, you know, the decision was just made that, and we stick to it, and that was really good, that the client has the same experience everywhere. So I often think that we developers, we sometimes forget that there is somebody using the system, and we try to do it based on what is new or cool or better, or, you know, and I think we here try to at least to find a good way in the middle. So I'm going to show you a couple of paragraphs and what we actually did to make them, how they were. So this is a typical paragraph. Okay. People, this is called hero image. But the client only wants to put in one image and not like having the slider. So you would think like, oh, this is easy. It's just a picture and text, subtitle and button with a link. Yeah, except the client wants to, of course, completely control where this text comes. Because if you look at his pictures, they have so beautiful pictures. They have photographers that go out there on the field and they take like all these pictures. So sometimes the person is on the right, sometimes he's on the left, sometimes he's up there and down there. So what did we allow them to do? They have nine different positions that they can choose to put their text on. So like upper left, middle left, down left, and so on. So nine positions. And that is a very, of course, not so easy, where it also has to work for, this has a very, you know, so much traffic, it has to work on Internet Explorer, Edge, it has to work on all kinds of iPads and iPhones and all that. So dealing with this positioning was not that simple like it looks like when you maybe estimate it and say like, yeah, it's gonna take a day to do it. No, I think it was more like a week. With the testing. So let's look at the backend. Now I'm logged in and I'm just gonna, you know, I see the hero image there. This is one of the paragraphs, this is the top paragraph. I go to edit. Somehow my screencast didn't show the dropdowns, but you can choose the content background color, the background color for the title. You can choose the headline position there. You can make all kinds of stuff. You can put an image and a URL. Yeah, and that's it. So if you play it, I think it is a GIF in this case, you just play it again. You see it very, very clearly. I'm going to show you also later like how the overview is very nice for the client. You go into edit. You can then choose the colors. And we decided, though, to only give him certain colors so it wouldn't be like, you know, on the front page, he was allowed to use all the colors he wanted with the results of that. It's very common.
Short question, and so the position of the text is of course some JavaScript function or custom module.
No, yeah, good question, because I was going to say that. It was in my notes. No, how we do it there is, we in pre-process function, we basically take the value of the field, that is then either the name, like, and we input it in the wrapper with the class. So it is really simple. And then we provide that in the CSS. So it's just a pre-process function. And this we basically do with all colors and positionings and background photos, stuff like that. So a very, very simple way to make the client extremely happy. I think like this function was worth of a lot of, you know, let's say money, you know, that sense, like, not that he was thinking in that direction, but it was so much worth for him to be able to do exactly this. Question.
So adding to this, so we like to put like layout into the template.
Yeah. You know, so like what you configure in the UI, you approve, configure how you want to have it, but actually this way it's moved to the templating layer. You know, and that makes it also like the usual process for front end developer to this, you know, create beautiful
stuff. Okay, yeah.
But for what did you use the preprocess? As you, I think normally you could just use the Twig template and do some kind of.
You want to keep the Twig templates simple and stupid.
Yeah.
Right? So, in an optimal world, all you do is Twig is your output stuff. That's how we like to do it. I'm not saying that that's the preferred way, but that's how we like to build it. That in the Twig template, you just output the stuff that is just put together nicely preprocessed.
Yeah.
That's how we think that these layers are going
to
be.
You don't want to make any revisions into it.
If it makes sense, you know, that you one template that you can make more generic and it's just really obvious that here, but that you think it's not something that would make sense, then we would do it. But we try to also, in order to be able to prototype beforehand, we want to have the prototype so we see that it looks nice and makes it very correctly. And so you want to have it in the template.
So guys, we are recording it, so we have to keep all like discussions there and minimum. So like you see that Christoph is, of course, he's in charge of the technology and why we maybe decide to do also stuff like that. So please have a talk with him maybe later about details, questions like that, please. Please do, because, you know, yeah. Center text, I want to just give you a couple of ideas of what you could, what you can actually do with paragraphs, you know, because you saw what you could do with playing around with the titles. So here you have a typical center text. So here they can, of course, also completely change the background photo. This is the background photo that they chose to put in because they had also graphical people there. They can also decide to have the color completely different. Again, the completely same mechanism, like same way how it is handled. You go in here. You know, you see that this is the paragraph that you're going to be dealing with. I'm going to show you later how we actually made this look so nice. That's very simple. You go to edit, there you just put in the text, you make the link, there you choose the background photo, here you, choose the coloring, and you can even give this paragraph an anchor in that case, so you can use that somewhere else, because often they have very long pages. So, this with the paragraph, like with the background photo and with the colors, made the same way display, like made with preprocess, where we inject this into templates. News slider was something interesting because if you remember what this is for, it's very many countries, 50 or 60 countries. So what they want to be able to do, they want to be able to work with a slider, news slider, and then they could use contextual filter and like show there only the slider that has the news for Nigeria. And not always just all news. So, and they want to be able to inject this wherever they want. So how did we do that? This is the typical news slider. In this case, it is just showing all news, but if you start going on the pages, for example, if you're reading about an event in or something in Nigeria, then you will, for example, to see all news from Nigeria. This is done an interesting way, what we actually did there. So you go to edit, and there you only put in, there's only one field in this paragraph. That is the contextual filter. And here you choose your country. So if you don't choose anything, you just get the default with everything. But if you put in a country, then it basically goes and we created a display suite field in, not in the UI, but in code, where you basically take the field from the paragraph, this one, and you inject that as a contextual filter in the view, and you display the view. So the client can, and this was just all thought from the client's perspective, that the client can really easily select, because we definitely do not want him to go into views and start there to create the duplicate views. No, never. And we also do not want the client to choose, and to, we do not want the client to go into the block structure and start to do only show on these pages, excluded, except from, you know, and starting to think about what region do we use. So we are really strict there. We do not, so the client has access to it, but he just, it just gets way too complicated if he's supposed to start to go in there and start to duplicate some views and displays inside the views. So this is something like that. Here is just a view, and like you see, in the corner up there, there's a contextual filter with region where that filter is just taken in, for those who are used to sighting. Then, of course, you know the problem with paragraphs is that the client was really early on, he said, yeah, hey, but I do not want to have to create the same paragraph again and again and again, because that's definitely not good. And that is something like a banner, an advertisement like this one. By you can tag MetaBiden. This is a typical banner that they create, and they just want to create that once, but still with paragraphs, inject that, sometimes on top, sometimes in the bottom, sometimes in the middle, sometimes in a CK editor, you know, wherever they want to be able. So there again, using paragraphs, yeah, this is the banner list, just an entity type that just has a couple of fields, like an image, you know. So they have already, I think, 120 banners that they are using on their site. And how you put it in, you know, we even show in the display what is in the banner, so it's also very easy for them to see what is there. But if you go to edit, yeah, the top one is the when you just go in, and the second one is if you press edit, then this part here, you see, this is the banner that you then insert. So at the moment you have to know the title of the banner, and you can imagine what is the next requirement of the client. It's like, can we now, like here, press a button where it then loads up a pop-up with all the banners, with teasers and everything, so I can select the right one, because sometimes I don't remember if it was ehrenamtliche Mitarbeiter or something else. But again, a paragraph that only has one field, which is an entity reference. The same is just with all these boxes. Again, a paragraph with three or six entity references. And here we are also using reusable elements. So these are, here you see the all six elements, and you go in there, and when you go in, you see only this one field, except the GIF is broken. I showed you now, I think, five of 25 paragraphs. These were the main like functionalities that are basically repeated again and again for the user to have it so flexible that he can do whatever he wants. But very early on in the project, we noticed that the default paragraph, when you go into edit and you have already chosen 10 paragraphs, that is very difficult to like have an overview of what is what in where. So look at this, you are now in edit mode. Sorry, I ignore that I pressed teaser. Here are the paragraphs. And we made that, and we spent a lot of effort of making that user-friendly. You know, you see, because the user just goes in and he sees immediately, like, where is the content that he is looking for. And this is just done with preview, the display preview. And if you go into the paragraph, you do manage displays. I even think I see it, show it here. Yeah, it's the next one. This is just inside the paragraph. There's this, you have to go first in custom display settings. You have to just click preview. It's not more than that. In Drupal 7, it was a little bit more complicated. It wasn't complicated, but you had to install a display suite. You had to install Drupal display suite forms or something like that to be able to get this. But here, just like in Drupal 8, it was very easy. So what about the CK editor and why? So like I told you earlier, we had to do some content with CK editor only because we had to inject the whole text. But the client, of course, wanted to make that text nice. It was not enough just to make paragraphs be low, you know, because that we wanted to have stuff inside. So we created a couple of special functions. So either we use the contrib modules, or we use, but maybe I go first then. So this is a typical page. And this here, the table of content gets automatically taken from the 8 tools that are in the content. So the client knows that when he makes the content, that everything that's going to be in H2 just automatically gets rendered. This is a view, contextual filter view, for that we inject in the middle. Like you see, you just there it has automatically all the scrolling functions, so you can read. And this is, for example, also an AM map. There's a chart, AM chart, that we take in based on the in the fields that are filled in on this country. So again, just to show you, like, you know, this was important that there is a table of content. This was just very simple to do based on the H2s, but we created a filter in CK Editor. So it doesn't happen always, it just happens for this type of filter. And then I'm going to show you a little bit how you put in this view. We created, so we use in generally for the CK Editor the two modules, Entity Embed and Entity Browser. So these are both contrib modules that you can use in Drupal 8 to like embed pictures and other entities. Then there is a module, contrib module, called Insert View, but it wasn't far enough. So we had to do a little special programming there, and that is in the, like, there is a dialogue there of if we can take it over or just put what we have done there in. And I'm going to show you the, I think I have here, in the insert view, it is basically here in the CK editor. Yeah, it's in the middle here. Let's let it run because it's already running. Here is an AM map token. So this is again very simple. This is just a little module that if you have this token inside of the CK editor, we created like the little button up there. And we just made the button nice. But you press on it and it automatically creates charts. A chart from the information that is in the node. And the insert view is also a button that is up there. So in the end, maybe a very simple structure. We tried to, like, you know, often when you go live with a page, you immediately think like, oh, yeah, I created a little bit too many content types, I created something too much. But we're very happy with the results here because we have a really clean version of the, you know, we do have very few content types. The paragraphs are all being used, and there was it was good decisions made on the way there. There's the insert view. You press the button up there. You get the typical where you can select the view that you want to have, and then you put in the contextual filter for it. You press OK, and then it gets like displayed inside of the content. If anybody is interested in knowing why is it red up there, you know, there's a really nice module called Environment Indicator. If you're not using it, I could tell you that this is a big help because you know now that you're in a live system. That's red, it's just really warning you that you're in a live system. Our test state system is yellow and dev is green. So green meaning that we can do whatever we want. And it's just a module that you just turn on and then with you can have different colors up there. I think, like I've said, maybe one thing that I want to add is that we used to have a lot of problems with the revisioning and the paragraphs. It's getting better, although Stefan is not here now. If anybody wants to, you know, if anybody has good experience with paragraphs and revisioning and Drupal 8, you know, and notes revisioning, then maybe come to me because we also have been having problems with that, and it would be good to discuss that a little bit. Otherwise, we are here in Frankfurt. You want to come by? If you're here in Frankfurt, come by. You find me on Twitter mostly, and of course the Lils project, but this the Drupal Iceland. If you want to come to Iceland next year or the year after, start to follow us now, and we will be so happy to have you. So little teaser for that last time, instead of giving away t-shirts or something like that, we sent everybody on a really big trip around Iceland. So that was a lot of fun. So thank you. If you have any questions, please ask. Yes.
Is it difficult to index nodes with paragraphs for search?
No. Index, in the end, it's just HTML that Google just writes.
No. I mean, for internal website search.
Ah, you mean for the search?
For the search, yes.
Yes. And honestly, we are not that far here.
Okay.
But we have been doing this in other projects, especially in the government projects we've been doing in Iceland. And then, yes, you have to make sure that you deliver the node. So if you're searching for something that is in a node reference,
yes.
That you look up if this is shown anywhere, and you have to do a little extra programming there, yes. It's definitely nothing that is out of the box yet, except anybody else has experience.
Thanks.
Yeah, Ruben.
So how does it work with translation? Is there a requirement?
Yeah, at the moment this is all in German. But we have prepared most of the things that is ready in English. So we have done some prototyping to make sure that this is not going to go bad when they need it in English. But this is not such a big requirement at the moment. Most likely, not everything is going to be translated one-on-one. It's going to be more like a little subset. Yes?
Just the same question, but do paragraphs work with content translation together? So, for example, I want to translate the node with the paragraphs, and then translate the node and the paragraph entities at once. Does this work?
Christoph, do you know? I know it works, but like how and do you know?
I mean, I just go to add translation and then I want to translate the node.
Yes.
And then the paragraph entities from German to English.
Yes.
And I want to do it in one. That's the question.
Yes. Yes.
So the translation just works like standard AAA translation.
Yes.
Right. So standard like content transparency translation, which we don't have in AAA like that anymore, or was Drupal 7. So. Like the standard translation mechanisms that follow the paragraphs that
work as well.
Yeah.
I just want to confirm this. It's working. Yes. Perfect. Yeah. So that's working. Yes.
Just to highlight that there is a wiki page in the inside documentation of the paragraph regarding the multi-language configuration.
Yeah.
And you have to be careful with not enable the not making the multilingual the HTML reference of the paragraph. If you don't do that, everything is working as.
Okay.
So you have to make it multilingual.
The entity reference to the paragraph itself, no. But the paragraph doesn't.
And what happens if you want to have different paragraph entities? There is different translations. Is that possible?
There is a wiki page with that information that I think right now is not, but there is a patch or something. It's something that is.
So I can just try to for Drupal Camp Schwerin, is it correct? Schwerin? Let's just try to have a session about how multilingual and paragraphs and how that all works together. And maybe if we can do a session there, I would be happy if all of you would come and we would then probably have it figured out. Until fall, how this really, like, if it is good or not working. Yeah, but good questions, very good. Yeah?
Have you considered using a distribution like Thunder or Lightning at the start of the project, and why didn't you use it? I guess you didn't.
No, we didn't. Mm. Do you want to answer why? Do you want to sit here, Christoph?
No.
A lot of people get like a headache.
No, it's simply because like we internally have we don't have distributions as such, but we have internally our ways of doing things.
Yeah.
And this is not how it's done in Lightning, and this is not how it's done in Thunder.
Yeah.
If you want to make something that you just give on to somebody else to use, in my opinion, it's a very good idea to use something like Lightning or Thunder or wherever else, you know, but for alternative use, you most likely want to have your own set of ways how you do things, and this is what we have, and therefore we are users.
Meaning internal use then for our client.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. We spent a little bit thinking about it, because maybe in the beginning of the project we didn't realize that this client was actually just, he wanted a newspaper.
Yeah.
Very flexible, and you know, maybe the decision would have gone like differently, you know, maybe or maybe not, you know, depending, but like that was not so clear in the beginning that they were so like so close to, for example, what Thunder is then maybe providing.
Maybe, yes.
Maybe. Yes, please.
How do you estimate? I know you have another session about the time estimation.
Thank you for the advertisement.
How do you estimate time? Because when I see this and I think how I would sell something like that to a customer, I would think all this complicated stuff you only see after the design and design phase. And normally you don't sell the design phase and afterwards the development, so it becomes could become really a problem afterwards when you design all this crazy stuff and then you have to do all this logic afterwards.
Yeah, so this was an agile project with the client. The client had a budget. The budget we defined inside of the budget, the main functionality, and then we said that we don't know how the rest is going to come out. Let's be just honest, let's try to do it, we do it in sprints. We work with the client in the sprints, and we really, you know, it was the job of the product manager and me just to make sure that this doesn't go out of scope. The client had very many other ideas about what he wanted in the beginning, where he then, because he also didn't know that this was possible, you know, he just didn't know that this was really possible. You know, then when he saw it, the way he started to, you know, then he started to ask the question, he said, like, is it possible to put it red and the left and the yellow and, you know, make it in all colors? Then he's like, yes, it is possible, but it's going to take definitely, if you're going to let this work on all devices and all browsers, you can definitely think that it's going to take 2 days at least just to make this here little thing work, that we maybe in the beginning estimated being 4 to 6 hours based on the design. And then we had to have these honest talks with the client and say, like, so do you really want it? And then what should we take out? Of course, difficult, because in the end the client still wants to have it all in what he wanted in the beginning. So he gets a little bit, you know, oh, but now the budget is done, but he was happy with the outcome, and we discussed every paragraph into very details. So we were lucky there, it was a budget agile project. Yeah, Ruben?
Really like what you achieved with the paragraphs. I wish I could download it from the blog.
Oh, me too. Yes. When did we start to talk about it? Yesterday? Anybody here? Ruben, let's take this discussion later. Why do we not just make features out of this? And so everybody can do, because these are these little boxes, little features. We were talking about it. Somebody told me that back in the old Drupal 7 or something, there were like these little feature sets that people could just a little bit plug in, ready-made stuff, which is a little bit missing now. I hear, at least this is what we were discussing yesterday, because we were discussing this. So why do we not take this? Now we have built this, and why should you not just all benefit from it and be able now to plug basically this paragraph, say, like, I want this paragraph. Good idea, let's take this further. Then there's going to be another talk in Schwerin about how we did features out of this paragraph. Okay, good. More ideas? Any more questions? So we're going to make this publicly available, probably on the website. Tomorrow at 9:45, I'm going to be discussing exactly the problems of estimation and why sometimes projects go wrong, because we cannot estimate this, that is going to be the result in the end, and what are the tricks and that we can do there. So I would really be happy if you all come there. I will then, if you all come, I will have it make it shorter about Iceland in the beginning. So thank you.